you. We're going to be starting in just a few minutes, but while we're waiting, we want to make sure if any of you have questions, there's an opportunity to ask them, and there are cards being passed around, and there are volunteers that can help either write them down for you or collect them. So if any of you have a question and you haven't had a chance to submit a card, or if you want to submit a second one, please raise your hand and one of the volunteers will come to you. And then once they're collected, we'll be starting in just a few minutes. So thank you again. We'll get it going. Thanks.
Water cooler in the back in the hallway. So again, if you're feeling
really hot during it. Feel free to go get a cup of water and come on back. We want you to make sure that you're all safe and comfortable. There are restrooms. If you go down the main corridor of the auditorium, if you go to the right, there's a far corridor there, and there are volunteers who can help you. As I mentioned earlier, there's opportunities for questions. Many of you have already submitted them. That's great. And we got some ahead of time. But if you have additional questions, if you raise your hand during the event, a volunteer can come over and help you fill out the card. We are also thrilled that this Wednesday is the last day to register to vote. And John Flynn, our town clerk in Watertown, is here. We appreciate John being here. And on one of the tables outside in the hallway, he has voter registration forms. So if you're not registered, or if you know somebody, your family is not registered, take a form, not just in Watertown, in any city and town, it has to be mailed back by Wednesday. So I encourage you, I don't encourage you to vote early on, but I do encourage you to register at least once in whatever town you live in. And if you have questions about how to do it, accessible voting, anything, John Flynn can answer those at the end so that you have your voice. We also have, there's flyers out there in September. There's something called Abilities Expo at the Heinz, at the Boston Convention Center, excuse me, at the end of September. So again, it's another opportunity for the community to come together. So I encourage you to take a flyer and participate, or if you're representing a group, think about having a table there at the Abilities Expo. So to do that. So without further ado, we're really thrilled to have our special moderator. Oh, and by the way, this is being broadcast both on TIC Network, on Perkins Radio Station, on YouTube, and other ways, so that if you want to watch this later, or if you have people who weren't able to be here, they can watch it later. I know that many people are tuning in live as well. So our moderator for the next hour and a half is Anthony Silva. He's been on WBZ for over 30 years. You all recognize his voice. And he is on from 3 to 8. He's a New England business editor. He produces 50 New England business reports a week. And he's won numerous awards, including the Champion Media Award for Economic Understanding, the Small Business Administration Reporter of the Year, Ohio State Award, and numerous awards. So without further ado, join me to welcome Anthony Silva, our moderator.
Being here with you this morning, discussing these issues that are very, very important to all of us. In terms of full disclosure, my son worked for the Helicopter Foundation for 5 years in New York, and he still works in the nonprofit sector in New York. I'm very proud of what he does. We have covered these types of stories for many, many years, and I am honored to be here so we can get into some of these real issues. I have a whole stack of questions from you. Thank you so much. And I also want to say that if you see me on my little iPhone here, I'm not updating my Facebook page, but I am keeping time also, getting some messages from some of the operatives here about what direction we can take. I learned a new term today, and that is from your president, that this is Hogwartian Hall. So I'm very happy to be here, and I'm expecting that the candles will float at any moment. Thank you so much. I do want to welcome our first representative of candidate Gabriel Gomez, Mary Zinni Connaughton. She's a CPA, pioneer director of finance and administration at local parent. She served on the former Boston Turnpike Authority Board of Directors, was a member of the Massachusetts Commission on Judicial Conduct, was on the board of directors of Commonwealth Corporation. She was chief financial officer of the Massachusetts State Lottery. Served in the State Treasurer's Office in 2010. Mary Z. Made an unsuccessful bid for her election for state auditor, but she had a great jingle. And I still hear it in my head. It's great. So welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
And the format today calls for Mary and Representative Markey to have up to 15 minutes to discuss with you some of the major issues of the day. So, now it's time for you.
Thank you, Anthony. And thank you, Stephen. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here to speak on behalf of Gabriel Gomez. tell you a little bit about Gabriel's background and then talk issues. Gabriel Gomez was born in the United States, the son of Colombian parents. They came to this country as immigrants to seek out the American dream. He grew up in a pretty much middle-class, typical background, except he grew up speaking Spanish. His mother thought that by the time he got to school, he'd be able to pick up English. As a result, he has mastered both languages. A very proud day for his parents was the day when Gabriel was accepted into the U.S. Naval Academy at Annapolis. But an even prouder day for his parents was the day they became citizens of the United States of America. Gabriel's highest honor was joining the Navy SEALs and wearing the uniform of his parents' adopted country and his own country. After leaving the military, Gabriel went to Harvard Business School and excelled working with retirement systems and helping small companies grow. He lives in Cohasset with his wife, Sarah. Sarah was a Peace Corps volunteer and a special education teacher. They have four children. Gabriel coaches softball, baseball, and serves on various town committees. Gabriel got into this race first and foremost because he believes that our people are better than our politics. He believes our country is better than our Congress. Now, Gabriel is not a polished politician. We don't need more of those in Congress. Seasoned politicians tend to speak for their party's interests and for special interests and seem to somehow lose track of our interests. Gabriel has already shown his independence. During the primary, a letter that he wrote to Governor Patrick asking that he be appointed to the interim U.S. Senate post was leaked to the press. In that letter, Gabriel expressed his praise for President Obama, citing his bold and thoughtful leadership. Many pundits thought the news of that letter would sink his candidacy. But his victory is a testament to how much voters crave to have an independent voice in the Senate, not one prone to party politics. I'm convinced that Gabriel Gomez will work in the best interest of Massachusetts rather than be another party line vote. He's already demonstrated his independence in other ways. He bucked his party by supporting expanding background checks for gun owners and eliminating the gun show loophole. He fully supports marriage equality for gay and lesbian couples. He favors comprehensive immigration reform, including building a pathway to citizenship for those who are already in this country. One of the great things about Massachusetts is our independence. In fact, we are one of the very few states where the majority of our citizens are not registered with a particular party. We're a free-thinking, independent lot. While many businesses in Massachusetts don't view themselves as being on the same team as Congress and the federal government. While many Massachusetts businesses are hurting right now, businesses in Washington, D.C. are booming. Lobbyists and special interest groups are thriving. The federal government continues to expand. It did under previous administrations, too. That's not the recipe for long-term sustainable growth. As a result, Washington has become dysfunctional. Both major parties point fingers at each other, and the result is gridlock in Congress, arbitrary across-the-board sequester cuts, they're the epitome of Washington dysfunction. In Congress, it's politics all the time. Whatever happened to the notion of working across the aisle, of profiles and courage? We need representatives who will put our country and our people first, even if that means they have to stand up against the leaders in their party and their positions. According to the Washington Post, Congressman Markey votes the party line 98% of the time. No one's right 98% of the time. The entire sequester gambit was created by politicians in Washington on both sides who wanted to push off their responsibilities until after last year's election. It's an irresponsible way to operate government. And those cuts affect us all. For instance, the Boston Globe just reported that thousands of the state's poorest residents are losing or being denied federal housing subsidies due to the sequester cuts. WBUR recently reported that the National Institutes of Health will lose 5% of its funding due to sequestration, and that amount will grow over the next decade. That means grants for medical research, much of which takes place in Massachusetts, will be reduced. Private philanthropies can't make up that difference. And when the hope of a major medical breakthrough is what gets many people out of bed in the morning, and I know one of those people very well, that's simply unacceptable. Gabriel believes that we should replace the sequester with common sense spending cuts that are not arbitrary. The government can and should tighten its belt and reduce spending, just like small businesses and families do all the time. The way the current sequester cuts are written, though, makes across-the-board cuts that are not arbitrary. So there's no flexibility within agencies to make changes to put those cuts where they can afford to make the cuts rather than across the board. Gabriel Gomez will work with Republicans and Democrats to find common ground on getting our spending under control. Finding the common ground is what he's all about. On his firsthand experience, Gabriel sees the world as a very dangerous place. He supports adequately funding the men and women who kiss their families goodbye and deploy to the danger zones across the world. These people earn our respect and trust, and they need representation in Washington, D.C. If you send Gabriel Gomez to the United States Senate, he will keep our soldiers, veterans, and their families in the forefront of his mind. Keeping people safe is what a Navy SEAL does. Gabriel believes that our country has to do a better job of taking care of our returning veterans, given the huge increase in disabled veterans from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, as well as the mental health issues that many veterans face. We need to make sure our veterans have proper access to mental health care when they get back. We also need to make sure that our disabled veterans, whether young or old, have access to the care they need and support to live independently. Gabriel knows there are definite areas in the defense budget that could be cut. However, he supports increasing money for training, connections they make while serving us to cash in later with special interest groups. Three, establish the line item veto. The single best way to curb unnecessary spending in Congress. Many states, including Massachusetts, have this, and it's a big part of avoiding wasteful spending and government debt. It's time for a fresh approach. These are common sense solutions that will work in the real world. We don't need more of the same in the U.S. Senate. Massachusetts needs an independent voice. With all due respect to Congressman Markey, 37 years is enough. I'll be voting for Gabriel Lopez on June 25th, and I ask that you consider doing the same. Thank you.
Federal funding, Medicare, Medicaid, from all of the cuts that we've been talking about in this question?
There should be a way, but what it's going to take is for Congress to work together. The issue is this, it's too much for Republican, Democrat, and the House is run by Republicans, the Senate run by Democrats, so it's just too much back and forth. And even within the Senate and the House, they're pretty narrow margins there. So we need to elect people that are going to cross the aisle, pick off that Republican and Democrat badge, and just work together. So things like this don't happen. So the sequester's cuts to the NIH, that's just plain wrong. The way to fix that is to get a Congress that works together and then done with partisan bickering and are not beholden to special interest groups. They just want to do the right thing for people.
Support that extra $250 million the Massachusetts hospitals are receiving under the current regulations, or would he vote to close that loophole that allows this? Obviously, that helps the medical the funding here in the state.
I don't know how he feels on that one, but what he's referring to is there's a way to calculate the formula for reimbursement based upon that the average cost of rural hospitals in a particular state. The issue with Massachusetts is that we have one rural hospital that's officially classified as a rural hospital, and that's on Nantucket. So the costs there are very high. As a result of that formula, Massachusetts gets more money. So I'm not sure how it feels on that issue, but it's certainly an issue that should be addressed. The formula was a bit suspect.
Sure. You know, I've reported on this story many times, which I call the unemployment rate. But when you look specifically at the unemployment rate for teenagers or the unemployment rate for blind or other disabled, it's just off the charts. What are the limits that the federal government can reach to help those who really are able to work, can work, with some help?
Well, Gabriel supports training programs, supports helping people find employment. I'm just on the way here, my friend Karen, the ride, what used to cost her $2 is now costing her $14. If she didn't have family members that were willing to drive her here, she is that needs representation to support programs to keep people working, to keep people living independently. And I would argue there's a very good economic argument for that, as well as a humane argument.
Sure. And I'm going to throw out the same question, and this is from somebody else. How would you reform Social Security disability so there are no disincentives to work?
Well, that's an issue. That's a big issue. Yeah. And as we know, the population, the number of people on Social Security disability is just going up and up and up. And the question is, how is the money going to be there 10 years from now? And to make responsible decisions today so there's money there going into the future.
It's a very large issue. And a few people ask the same question, and that's about the United Nations Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. As you know, the Senate failed to ratify that convention. It was 5 votes short, which impacts people with disabilities worldwide. Senator Kerry was a lead proponent in that. Boston Globe story actually quoted President Perkins in favor of this. How could that happen? I mean, that does not directly affect the United States, but it was just to prevent this from moving forward. And it was opposition from the Republicans that prevented this from happening.
Well, and that's the whole issue with a lot of things that happen in Washington, D.C. It's people that are just too tied to their party's interests, that have a separate deal going on this side, so they're going to make a decision on this side that affects that side. And again, it comes down to too much party politics, too many people that are not willing to be independent, that are not willing to say good things about the other guy, that are not willing to cross the aisle and work with people that are more interested in just towing the party line. When that happens, it's simply not a good thing for anyone, because we all lose.
You mentioned this as well, and that in your talk, and that is about your views on independent living. Obviously, there are real advantages in keeping those who are disabled in their homes, and also, if possible, working as well. But again, there's limited resources.
There's limited resources, but again, it's looking at where we are spending money and where we can save. I mean, making sure that people have PCAs in their home, that there's full programs for that. The nursing home is not a good option for many people. The ones are costing a lot more money. And again, it's good common sense. People should live independently as long as possible and find programs that are going to promote that. It's something that Gabriel would support.
What new legislation do you see Mr. Gomez and others filing in the near term that would affect, I guess, the disabled in a positive way? Is there anything that you could mention that you would be unsure of right now?
I know he supports programs to help employment, but I also think his way of looking at Washington and how Washington can be reshaped by establishing term limits, by getting people out of the lobbying business and not having that carrot dangling in front of them when they're supposedly acting in our best interest, I think that would lead to a lot more healthy lawmaking. And certainly, establishing the line item veto for programs that just, you know, that just endure for a long period of time, they're taking money from programs that are needed. You know, and again, it's changing the attitude in Washington away from Democrats and Republicans and looking towards independence. That's what is needed in the long run.
Along with sort of the same train of thought, one of our participants here cited the recent Wall Street Journal article, which indicated that 400 corporate leaders actually said they're reluctant to hire the law. First of all, I guess the number one question is, does government have a role in that equation? And number two, what steps, if there is a role, would Mr. Gomez take to influence that change in the future? Oops.
Well, any act of discrimination, the government has a right to step in if people are being discriminated against based upon a disability. And I'm not sure of the specifics that Gabriel has on this. Again, that's something that I could get to him on and have him get back to you on. So we can resolve that. That's a very good question.
That's a great question. Tell me why he's perfect for the job.
The one thing that we need is independence. As I said earlier, Massachusetts, the majority majority of citizens are not with the political party. Independence is what made this country great, and he will be an independent servant for us.
Now, we did say earlier that not all questions would be circling around these disabled issues, okay? So I got two that are not directly affected. One is, and this is from folks here, why is Mr. Gomez refusing to voluntarily disclose donors so we can judge for ourselves who has this interest and who's supporting him?
I don't have an answer to that question. Again, that's another one
that I've
got. Okay. Okay, and I'm not
familiar with that. I won't keep this up. I promise.
I apologize. I can't.
It's somewhat unfair, I understand, because Ms. Gomez is not here. How would you explain taking that $300,000 as a tax break for not renovating this home? I mean, it's been a big issue, and it is in the public record. And you're, as you know, when you announce candidacy, the door is open to your life.
The door is open up, right? It's an open door. Well, I think the Boston Globe editorial summed it up well. But even the Boston Globe said you can't really criticize someone for taking advantage of their tax code. People do it all the time, whether it's charitable deductions, a mortgage interest deduction. If it's a legal deduction, if it was illegal, absolutely not. But it was a legal deduction passed through, you know, Congress, whether it's one that should be changed, I believe it has to change. Well, so be it. But you know, it's hard to criticize someone following the tax law if they're to their advantage. But quite often, any deduction people take is to their advantage. That was just a big one.
Sure. Thanks. Very good. Let's turn to Superstorm Sandy and FEMA's role in that. What would you suggest Congress could do better and FEMA could do better? Serving the most vulnerable in crisis like this. Obviously, there are so many challenges to people who have homes, to people who are losing their homes, but those who have disabilities as well.
Sure, there should be some type of anticipation is the best offense, knowing what can be coming and having programs in place. You know, whether it's through using social media, if social media happens to be up, or texting, or technology, to make sure that the communications are strong. Communications in any type of crisis is the number one issue. It's what saves lives. And I think that having FEMA focus on communications among populations that are more at risk in a crisis is a really good starting point.
Would Mr. Gomez support a widely held position among Republicans that if indeed any budget is added to it, that something else needs to be added? That FEMA is a perfect example. That if extra FEMA aid was needed, whether it's Superstorm Sandy or Tornado,
well, I know that
other cuts are needed.
What many Republicans are asked to sign is a no new tax pledge, and he refused to sign that. So that means that for every increase in one area spending, there has to be a cut. That's basically saying we have to operate on the same budget. So if he hasn't signed that pledge, to me, it's proof that he's open to new ideas, new ways of funding programs.
Great. That's a great question. Again, not directly related to some of the issues here, but could you explain Gabriel Gomez's job? What does he do now?
Well, he left his job to run the U.S. Senate. He worked for Summit Partners and Advent International. They are basically venture capital firms that provide seed money and other funding to help companies grow, help biotech companies grow, help high-tech companies grow. It's a necessary stage for the companies grow before they go for an IPO, initial public offering, and selling stock to the public. Quite often they get funded by venture capitalists to get them to that next stage so they can continue to grow, they can continue to do research, they can continue to invest in products.
And does he have any experience dealing with people with disabilities? Do that work?
I'm not aware of that. I do know his wife was a special education teacher.
His wife was a special education teacher?
Was a special education teacher.
And now, the Americans with Disabilities Act, this is a long question, bear with me, passed almost 23 years ago, with one of its goals being to increase employment opportunities for people with disabilities. Today, the unemployment rate for people with disabilities has not changed significantly since the law passed. Would you support the Department of Labor's proposed rule change that would require federal contractors and subcontractors to set a hiring goal of 7% for the employment of people with disabilities. Why?
I don't know Gabriel's answer to that question, but that's the third question I'll get back to you on, because that's certainly an important question that should be answered. I just don't know the answer to that.
That's fine. That's understandable. How can the federal government help municipal disability commissions enforce the ADA? Obviously, especially in smaller towns, there's really limited resources.
Right. And, well, there's not a whole lot of leverage currently to do that. They do provide a lot of grants that we could, with all the disabilities, if they want to do some leverage. Right now, I believe it's more up to the state to support that, but there's not a lot of particular
Okay. How would Senator Gomez bring to daylight issues of mental health care that face so many American families? In particular, what this question is thinking about is mental health and military veterans.
Well, that's a big issue with Gabriel. He believes that more funding should take place. There's simply not enough funding for people that are coming back from the war, from Iraq or Afghanistan. And a lot of the issues right now are actually being, they're undetected. So a serviceman comes back and he gets redeployed, he or she gets redeployed, but the issue hasn't been detected. And so he would support more understanding of what's happening to servicemen as they return inland, and certainly supporting more funding for mental health care services for people.
This goes into the whole issue of ground transportation. And being in Boston this past weekend, and you just realize a simple federal mandate of curb cuts changed people's lives. Just that. But that was a federal mandate. That was the government on our back. Something Republicans always said, get the government on our back. What would you do to make the U.S. transportation systems more accessible? And is there a government goal in there?
Our roads and bridges are in terrible shape right now. The number of structurally deficient bridges in this country is still unreasonably high. There's issues with how well transportation in general is being funded. Right now in Massachusetts, when you buy a gallon of gas, 21 cents goes to the state government, 18 and a half cents goes to the federal government, there's another 2.5 cents that goes to the underground storage tank. The question is, how are we adequately funding our transportation systems? And I would say we are not funding them to serve the best interests of Congress and people getting around. So certainly that's an underfunded area. It's important.
I know this has been an issue as well, and that is gun control and what role that should play. What is Mr. Gomez's position on banning assault weapons and also the broader gun debate of mandatory registration background checks?
This is an area where Gabriel Gomez certainly did buck his party in that he supports background checks and eliminating the gun show loopholes for gun owners. He also believes that when they initially had done in the past, an assault gun ban, that it did not impact the number of violent crimes. He does not support a ban on assault guns, but certainly does support making sure that those who own the guns have the competency and have the necessary background credentials to manage that ownership.
Okay, going back to education, especially locally, how can we ensure that charter schools meet the requirements to educate students with disabilities? And I'm not sure what the regulations are charter schools, if they are different than the public school system.
Well, the charter schools are supposed to follow the same guidelines as traditional public schools. They're all public schools. The charter schools are actually chartered by the state, so they're not part of the school district. But they're subject to the same requirements for educating every child to his or her potential as traditional schools are.
Excellent. This is an interesting question. In light of the recent federal communications program, technology and training the people through our deadline, whom I can connect. Now the computer's efforts to make these devices more accessible to people who are blind. What role do you see in emerging technologies? What role will that play in fostering the independence of people with disabilities and increasing their access to information? And is there a government role in ensuring that that access grows?
Certainly anything that the government can do to push it along is helpful. R&D research and development going into that area, I would assume, is very strong and robust here in Massachusetts. But more can be done. As I said earlier, communications is the key to successful performance. And inadequate communication just leads to inadequate results. And I refer back to the situation with my brother and the loss of his vision, most of his vision. And he's an engineer. Work with manuals all the time. Trying to find a way for him to be able to perform his job was quite a challenge. And if it wasn't for an investment that someone made in technology, he wouldn't be able to do his job.
What can the Senate and the House of Representatives do in concert to help the doors of colleges and universities swing wide open enough to easily admit adults and students with disabilities? The Acting Assistant Secretary of Special Education and Rehabilitation Services, Michael Newton, recently visited Burgess and took students and staff at the School of Science Fair talking about the STEM program, saying that it's essential to meet President Obama's goal of adding America leading the world in college completions by 2012. And he also said that people with disabilities must be counted among those future college grads in order to reach that goal, but under the current circumstances, it's very difficult in many colleges around the country for those with disabilities to enjoy that same opportunity. So is there a federal role in this?
Much better than it currently is. It's too low, those levels, and the government should, at least in my opinion, I can't speak for Gabriel, but it's certainly in my opinion, make sure that there's access and programs so every individual can achieve his or her highest potential. Should be the right place.
Well, as you give your opinion, especially with your own family history, what do you feel is the most misunderstood aspect of special education and those who who have special needs in the education system?
Well, every family has their own view on that. In my family, I deal with IEPs for one of my children, and I feel that in his case, there's a certain level of children that don't have obvious disabilities, and it's really hard for them because they tend to just get pushed on. Mm-hmm. And many parents simply aren't well-versed in what they need to do to get the child the services they need. Or they're intimidated by the school, for those cases. And they don't want to have the school incur additional costs. And that's not right. Parents need to understand what their role is and what they can do to help their children. But again, the communication, I think that area is, it needs fast.
Yeah, so sometimes I think in this state we have a somewhat skewed view of what those opportunities may be when we compare them to other states around the country. Last Friday, the federal government released a report saying that the Medicare Hospital Trust Fund will run out in 2026. Social Security Trust Fund will run out in 2033. And I was quick to point out that it's not mean that checks will stop, but Social Security will be able to cover 75%. What do you think one senator can do to make a positive difference in that timeline? Is it time to make some small changes in Social Security to ensure the its longevity, or do we need a major heart transplant there?
Well, the good news, and there was good news in that report on Friday, the good news is that it was scheduled to run out and was met there in 2024. So now it's 2026, so that's a step in the right direction. I don't know if they just changed the assumptions. But we have to make sure that, you know, if we made a promise to people, we should keep that promise. But there are changes we can make, perhaps for younger employees or workers, and I believe Gabriel supports this, to preserve the programs for the long haul so it doesn't come out. But again, a promise made should be a promise kept.
You know, over, I think an overall theme of a lot of these questions from all of you today is the role of government. And, you know, to look at what the role of government can be, and that is a viable, lively debate in Washington now. And generally speaking, what are Gabriel Gomez's views on that? That it doesn't come from a place, because, you know, well, many people don't know, I guess. Does it come from a place of, and we've heard this over and over again, let's do everything possible to get government on our back? Or does it come from a view of government definitely has a role, a historic role and responsibility, especially for those who are most vulnerable?
I believe that Gabriel believes that there is clearly a role for government. There's a role, though, that the government has to act responsibly. Government has to spend appropriately, spend our money appropriately. They're stewards of our cash. And when society doesn't function to the way to its fullest, sometimes government does have to step in. But government also has to be of the people. They can't be acting in the employees, Congress has to be acting in our interest, not in their own interest. And that's why he supports Ban for Life, congressmen that are ultimately going to be members of special interest groups or lobbyists. He thinks the line item veto is critical in having an effective government that's accountable to its people, and doesn't overspend just to spend, doesn't incur debt for all of us and our children, our grandchildren, for years to come. There's a role for government. I think Gabriel has that good balance. You know, he's not looking at it at this race as a Republican Democrat, he's looking at it as, you know, he wants to do the right thing for the people. And so much of the spending and things that happen in Congress aren't for the right reasons. And, you know, and even if they are for the right reasons, people don't believe they're for the right reasons because of the special interest, the lobbying afterwards. You just have to kind of clean it up so people have trust in government.
I want to promise you, I was not planning this question when I asked the last question, but it was the next part that came up, okay? And that is, among those promises of government role is Obamacare among those. How can disabled Americans best manage their options under the Affordable Care Act, and would Senator Gomez support the continuation of the Affordable Care Act?
Senator Gomez believes that it should be up to the states to decide how they're going to manage health care in the states. In Massachusetts, we had a system that was working pretty well. 98% of people were covered under Massachusetts health care reform in 2006. There are definitely some impacts that the Affordable Care Act is going to have on Massachusetts residents that aren't good. The tax on medical device manufacturers is going to hurt us. It's a lot of money. And with all the manufacturers here in Massachusetts, that's another blow to how they choose to invest their money. Additionally, the way that premiums can be established have changed now under Massachusetts law, where there are other rating factors that can be considered in determining what premiums are going to be. Under the Affordable Care Act, that number is going down to three or four or smaller amount, which means that many small businesses in the state, never mind the normal increases in healthcare costs, but simply because of the changes in rating factors, they're going to be paying higher premiums. So a one-size-fits-all approach doesn't necessarily work. In Massachusetts, we already have these pre-existing conditions or requirements, which is part of the Affordable Care Act. So the question is, what do we stand to gain from ACA versus what it's going to cost us in Massachusetts?
thank you very much for being in the hot seat for the last hour or so. Thank you very much. I think she was here a little longer than she had planned, but I really appreciate it. Representative Markey is here, and I wanted to introduce him for our next segment of our program. Come on down. Envision to his work on energy and environmental issues. Representative Markey has served 20 years as chair of or the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Telecommunications and the Internet, where he was the principal author of many laws governing our nation's communication systems, including the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act, which ensures access to information and communication technologies for people with disabilities. Would you welcome Representative Markey?
Accessibility Enhancement Act, which required the government to ensure that communications States with screens larger than 13 inches. This enabled Americans who are deaf or hard of hearing to more fully participate in the world by requiring televisions to display closed captions. In 1990, we also passed the landmark Americans with Disabilities Act, the ADA. And the ADA was an historic victory. Before it became law, the need for accessibility for Americans who were blind, hearing impaired, or in need of extra assistance was an afterthought, if it was a thought at all. That was shameful, and the ADA made great progress in giving accessibility a more prominent place in the American vocabulary. The ADA required accommodations for those with disabilities, including interpreters, readers, and devices so that people can participate in employment and public accommodations. Then, in 1996, we passed the Telecommunications Act. And that law required telecommunications services and equipment to be accessible to and usable by persons with disabilities and prohibited phone companies from installing network features that do not comply with the accessibility rules. That bill also directed the FCC to implement rules on closed captioning requiring the content to be accessible, and I was the principal Democratic author of that legislation. Then, in 2010, I was proud to write the capstone law that represents the culmination of all of these efforts. 20 years ago, the ADA mandated physical ramps into buildings. But by 2010, we needed online ramps to the internet. It used to be about being wheelchair accessible. Now it's also about being web accessible. Individuals with disabilities should be able to get online from anywhere. So, on the 20th anniversary of the ADA, the House of Representatives passed by law, and I spoke to the students at the Perkins and the Carroll School on that incredible day, July 26, 2010. I was down in Washington, and the students were up here participating by way of teleconference. Unlike the previous laws, the Congress had passed laws that primarily were attempting to catch up with old technologies. The CBAA is meant to ensure that no one is ever left behind again when it comes to emerging 21st century communications technologies. That means that smartphones, tablets, set-top boxes, and the universe of apps, devices, and services still in the mind of some 15-year-old whiz kid somewhere in the world should be designed with accessibility in the first place and not added sometime later. The CBAA, the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act, was a truly progressive law, a forward-thinking law, a law that will apply to new technologies as they emerge. I am proud to have been the House author of the CBAA. My law updated the ADA for the internet age, and what does that mean? Well, it means getting on the web easier and enjoying TV more fully through audible descriptions of the online action, enabling Americans who are deaf to watch TV programs online with captions, requiring remote controls to have a button or to easily access the closed captioning, making sure that deafblind Americans get the equipment they need to have access to the internet and telecom services. The bill allocated $10 billion to provide these services, including tablets, mobile phones, laptops, and braille displays. And it requires telephone companies used to make calls over the internet to be compatible with hearing aids. So what does it mean? Because of this law, if you miss Mad Men on TV, you can watch it with captions on your iPad. You can open an app on your mobile device with your voice, not just with your fingers. You can ask your phone to tell you aloud who is calling and tell it to read text messages to you. We now have talking music players that speak the artist and song name on some of the phones. We have programs that use the phone's camera to identify objects and colors of people who are blind. We have web browsers that can read web pages to you. And also, expressive voices that can laugh, or cry, or yell, depending on the chat icons used in a text or an email message. And the engineers are working on more features as we speak, and that is the way that it should be. And so, when Andy Sullivan went down to Alabama to talk to, for the first time, this family in Alabama, about their daughter, Helen Keller. She had to devise a way of talking to Helen Keller using her palm. It was brilliant. It revolutionized communication. But now, we move on from the palm to the Palm Pilot, and to the iPhone, and to every other device that is now mobile. And so, we need to have something in the palm of each person's hand that they can use in this modern era in order to be able to communicate. And that is what my law was able to do. Implementation of this law has been a tremendous success. After receiving strong bipartisan support in Congress, the FCC has worked swiftly with industry to make these provisions a reality. Industry is working closely with the FCC and consumers to effectively implement this landmark law. And don't forget, implementing this law is a job creator. Companies and innovators are coming up with new ways to make sure we meet these new requirements. We've also made some great strides in healthcare. Signing the president's healthcare reform law was one of the proudest votes of my career. Under that law, insurance companies can no longer deny people with disabilities based upon a pre-existing condition. And it's now unlawful to charge higher premiums based upon a disability. And I'm very proud of that vote. It's my proudest vote.
Thank you.
people with disabilities, and you can count on my support in the Senate to champion these issues. We also have work to do when it comes to sequestration. Sequestration is a fancy word for cuts, mindless cuts. Sequestration means that Social Security Administration will cut public services which could slow down disability claims. They're estimated that the applicants will have to wait 2 weeks longer for a decision on disability claims and nearly a month longer for disability hearing decisions. Sequestration cuts grants for special education. Here in Massachusetts, we face a loss of $14 million in special education funding. And sequestration means a $1.9 billion cut in housing assistance for the elderly and for people with disabilities across the United States. I voted against sequestration because I didn't think it was a responsible force for our country to be protected. And I will work on to overturn sequestration. I want to go to the Senate in order to make sure that cuts in funding for individuals with disabilities are not on the table. That is the responsible thing to do. And let me just move on to chain CPI, because it's a complicated term, but all it really stands for is cutting people's income. And that includes Social Security Disability Insurance, or SSDI. Switching to chain CPI would change the way Social Security calculates benefits. That new number won't keep up with inflation on things like food and healthcare, the basics that we need to live. For the average SSDI recipient, chain CPI would cut about $347 a year in the first 10 years, $720 a year after 20 years, and $1,000 a year after 30 years from disability payments. I oppose that change. In Washington, I will protect against chain CPI. In 1887, when Andy Sullivan began working with six-year-old Helen Keller, the Civil War was still fresh in people's minds. The end of the Civil War and the adoption of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution in 1868 is actually a fitting reference point for the long struggle for accessibility for Americans with disabilities. That's because the 14th Amendment and its Equal Protection Clause was supposed to fulfill our country's commitment to the ideal that all Americans are created equal, and all are entitled to equal treatment under the law. It didn't work out that way, however. Starting soon after the Civil War, separate and unequal was the way things were really done. It took another 100 years and the Civil Rights Movement to break down the legal barriers that had been used to enforce racial segregation. Of course, even then, we still faced obstacles preventing the equal treatment of women and minorities and people with disabilities. And as you know better than anyone else, some barriers to accessibility for Americans with disabilities still remain in place today. As the world changes and new technologies and services arrive, we have to remember it's never intrinsically for the better or for the worse. New technologies and services are only good when we animate them with the human values, equal opportunity, and access for all that reflect the best of what we are as a society. These are timeless American values that were as relevant when Annie Sullivan and Helen Keller were working together as they are today. When we expand the circle of inclusion, we evolve as a people. And when we increase accessibility for Americans with disabilities, we get closer to fulfilling the ideals of our nation's founders, that all men and women are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. To continue in this tradition, we will need your energy, your activism, your advocacy to move forward as a country, to continue the work of Helen Keller and Annie Sullivan in the Senate. I will make sure we live up to your work here. I thank you for inviting me back here. Thank you.
questions. These wonderful people who came here today.
Great.
I'd like to start with something that you referred to during your speech right now. And that is something that must be very frustrating. And people keep asking, what is the answer? And that is, what can be done to lift this culture of gridlock in the House and the Senate, that there are people that are there who seemingly are dedicated to blocking any legislation whatsoever? How do you get around that?
Well, you have to do what I did in 2010 in putting together a coalition of Democrats and Republicans who wanted to create an on-ramp to the internet for every citizen, including the deaf and the blind. And you have to find like-minded Republicans who will partner with you in order to pass that legislation. And so, ultimately, that's your challenge. And in this area, especially, it is something that I'm very proud of, because I've been the author or co-author of every one of these bills over the years that have just transformed the relationship that exists between this community and technology. And in each and every instance, it has been thoroughly bipartisan. Because in many of these instances, the industry wanted to move more slowly. The industry was raising doubts about whether or not they could do it at all. They were saying it was too costly. They were saying the technical obstacles were too great. But you know, there were Republicans who wanted to work with me, who felt it was more important to say that this challenge must be undertaken and we must find a solution. So each one of those bills is thoroughly bipartisan. All of the laws that I just mentioned, that I was the author or co-author of, that gives each person a technology in their hand that actually helps them to communicate and use their God-given abilities in a way that pretty much everyone else does. And we did it in a bipartisan way. So I want to go to the Senate to, once again, work with people in that way, to approach people from a human perspective and just say, this is a problem. We have to work together, put aside partisanship, find a solution, and pass the laws, the three of which really do help the families of our
country. I want to give you a chance to philosophize a bit. I was touched by this question today. I really was. And that is, one of our participants here today said, why, when this demographic is so small, did you decide to come here and speak to them?
Well, it may be small, but it may also be a lot larger than people think. There are many people out there, deaf, blind, that people think they're a little in the shadows, but they're a very real part of our community, and it's our job to make sure that they're able to be full participants in our society. So I come here because I've made this issue one of the central issues of my entire career, to make sure that everyone is included in the telecommunications revolution. It's the way in which people work. It's the way in which people go to school. It's the way in which people communicate with their families. And the faster the telecommunications revolution moves, is the faster people can get left behind and isolated. So I've always felt on every major piece of telecommunications legislation that it is critical to ensure that we also protected those who had disabilities which otherwise would be forgotten. And now there are thousands of new jobs that are being created across the information communications industries, as they now realize that there actually is a big market for this product, that people want these products, that there is an audience out there. So for me, I come here because this is the audience with which I identify. This is why I am a Democrat. It's important when you are working with the most powerful communications companies to
want to move on to the sequester. And that is, we have a few questions about the sequester, and those who wrote the questions all understand that when the sequester was first proposed, it was a debate about where it came from, but when it was first proposed, it was felt in the House and the Senate that this was so devastating that changes would come to prevent it from happening. But now that's happened, will there be some kind of way to protect disabled people who receive federal funding, Medicare and Medicaid, from these steeping cuts in the sequester? And they are felt, obviously, on those front lines.
Well, there are serious cuts that will happen automatically, almost like a sword of Damocles. It just keeps cutting and cutting and cutting programs that are at the heart of what it is that our government should be providing. So the government really is what we all decide to do together that we can't really do alone. And in my opinion, the way that sequestration is structured is that those most in need are equally harmed as those who have no needs whatsoever. And that's just not the way our government is structured. We should make sure that the funding is there for the programs that affect those who need the government the most. And if I am successful in winning the Senate seat, I am going to go down to fight to repeal sequestration so that we can sit down and do this in a way that isn't just mindless, but also includes the heart of our nation, so that we do respond to the real needs that are inside of our country. And that is going to be an essential part of the fight that I take along.
Another of the questions have to do with the Affordable Care Act, and I'm sure you know this firsthand, that the House has voted dozens of times, I guess, to overturn it, throw it out, to kill it, and also voting to not fund certain provisions in the Affordable Care Act. How do disabled Americans best manage their options, and more importantly, the fear that many people here feel is that their hopes of the Affordable Care Act could be decimated in the years ahead?
That's a very important question. The Affordable Care Act is essential. It basically says that if you have a pre-existing condition, you can no longer be denied health insurance. And it's not just for people here in Massachusetts, it's all across the United States. And if you can't afford health insurance, then you will be helped to afford health insurance. That is, I think, a very important ingredient in creating an environment where people don't have to worry if they're not employed. People don't have to worry if they have to move from job to job, from state to state. It gives people who need that kind of health care assistance the confidence that it's going to be there. And I just think that it's part, again, of ensuring that the human dignity of each person is, in fact, protected. And, you know, Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote that health is the first right. And we have a responsibility to make sure that we give that wealth, which is health, to each person. And so I'm going to go to the United States Senate to make sure that never do we have to read that the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare is repealed. It should stay on the books, and it should stay on the books forever, and if anything, improve to make sure that we do take care of every citizen.
Here's another question in reference to something you mentioned, Congressman, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. The Senate failed to ratify this convention with like 5 votes. It impacts people with disabilities worldwide. Senator Kennedy was a lead proponent. Senator Brown voted with the disability community, but still it lost. What could be done differently? What new path could be followed to bring more Republicans to support this very powerful convention?
Well, we have to do what I was able to do in 2010, what I was able to do in 1996, and that is we have to continue to work with Republicans, bring them in to explain how it's better when everyone's rights are affected and things than not. And there is a pathway to accomplishing that role. That's been the hallmark of my career in working in this entire area. And it requires going member to member to member to member to member to member, having a conversation with them, visiting them in the offices, explaining to them the consequences of not passing the STAR legislation, and what the benefits will be if we pass it. So that is the way in which I have worked in the past in this area. That is what I will do over in the Senate. And part of it as well, let me just be honest, is the lobbying ability of the people here in this audience and all across the country. Because the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act, it empowers the people in this community to communicate with their senators, to communicate with members of the House of Representatives in a way which they've never had before. It's easy and powerful. So I would also work to mobilize this community, to let them know in the Senate how much attention is being paid to their lack of attention to the needs of this community.
I need to ask you a question that has come up in the political advertising that's been aimed at you, and that is the allegation is that you voted in favor of tax cuts. I think it's hundreds of times, but I lost track. Tell me about that. What does a congressman face in that vote, and is that any measure of reality?
My goal is always to ensure that there is tax fairness, that there is a balance, which is constructive. And so for me, I vote to take away the tax breaks of the oil industry. You know, giving an oil company a tax break to drill for oil would be like, you know, giving a fish a subsidy to swim, a bird to fly. Just not necessary. Same thing is true for tax breaks for multinationals that ship jobs offshore, use the Cayman Islands as a tax haven. Same thing is true for billionaires who got to escape paying their fair share of the taxes in our society. So my goal has always been to try to protect the middle class, and over the last 15 years, I have voted $1 trillion worth of tax breaks for middle class families, including, for example, a $15 billion first-time homeowner's tax break. So that's all part of my philosophy. So yes, I actually bring out amendments onto the House floor to take away tax breaks. Much of that is included in the numbers which you list over here. And I'm going to continue to try to wage that battle on behalf of taxpayers for all Americans.
Would you support that loophole that allows Massachusetts hospitals to get that $250 million in extra funds, you know, for public health and health benefits here in Massachusetts?
Yes, I do, and I'm leading the efforts to preserve.
You have at least one main supporter here. The question verbatim. You have been the, underline, leader in accessible technology in Washington. So what is next?
It's probably in the technology area, a fight that we'll have with some industry as a new device, a new app is invented that will say, oh, that falls outside the boundaries of our capacity to be able to adjust, adapt, invent. And of course, we always know that we are this world is away. And so it takes constant pressure just to make sure that the Federal Communications Commission continues on the course which we have set. But I would say that the new frontier, of course, is the entire plan. We need to technologies all across the country. And by the way, that will also be good for American manufacturers. You know, as we invent these devices, there are the equivalent to the perfect school in every single country in the world. Just waiting for these breakthroughs. Millions, tens of millions whose lives are being transformed. And it's our job just to continue to make that case to do it here nationally.
We have time for two more questions. Not all the questions have to do with disabilities, but one of the teachers here wanted to ask the bombings at the Boston Marathon. Has the Senate looking at the fine laws, overhauling immigration policy? What is your stand on that issue, and has it changed since the Marathon attacks?
My belief is that we need to create a legal pathway for citizenship for those who are already in our country. One of the ironies, of course, of immigration legislation is that it would provide more information to the federal government, because people would come up from the shadows and provide that additional information to our country. So, in many ways, it's actually going to enhance law enforcement as people provide more documentation, more information about their families, and make them actually a greater part of the fabric of our society. That would enhance the likelihood that they too would have a stake in making sure that any terrorist group, any individual that would harm America would be harming their families as well as Americans. So I would say that no, we have to continue going, even as we learn the lessons of what happened on Marathon Monday, ensure this greater cooperation with Russia and with other countries in the sharing of information. By the way, another point, sequestration cuts $3 billion out of Homeland Security funding, so it's important for us to again repeal, especially in the wake of what happened on Marathon Monday, the sequestration of provisions that would have cut those programs, and then perhaps have voices and records, whatever, but in terms of immigration, I would say we should just continue to proceed.
You know, many of these questions deal with the real challenges that the disabled face, whether it's accessibility of information or their equal treatment in the job race. In that frame, what are some of the more important challenges that you would face in the Senate to increase that accessibility, increase the fact that the chances of the disabled getting jobs? There's one proposal that the Department of Labor changed the rule that required federal contractors and subcontractors to set hiring goal at 7% for the employment of people with disabilities. Would you support that, and is that those some of the things that we can look forward to in the future?
Well, unemployment is unacceptable. And one of the things, actually, that online access to information, the use of those technologies, is going to abolish is to make this community much more employable, because the technologies are now accessible in the office. And many of these offices now just use wireless technologies, which is what the revolution is all about. And young people who are being educated here today are going to leave with a full complement of all the skills which they need, but we have to make sure that we extend them over to the adult community as well. That's a challenge, but I think it's one that we can surmount, because this is a central issue: employment, self-sufficiency, making sure that people can provide for themselves, even as we ensure that the programs and the government are being there to those who need help. So that would be one of my goals, to support that goal. And I thank you, Anthony, and I thank everyone here for inviting me.
Yes, thank you very much.
Channel, Perkins Radio.
checking the buffering of the back.